I'll briefly present a case which we typically call chance. This is the story of a teenage boy named Maxwell Morrison in the US. This was in the 1980s. He was going through this typical teenage rebel phase. He had long hair and he had multiple ear piercings and tattoos. But more than all that, he always carried with him a flip knife that he kept playing with. And this made him look very dangerous. And so everybody, all his classmates, children in the neighborhood, they all avoided him. And one day he noticed the three boys, more or less his age, they were bullying a small child, an immigrant, in the neighborhood. They were trying to push this boy into a river, and that child kept crying, "I can't swim, I'll drown." They weren't listening. They were about to push him into the water when Maxwell came there and confronted these three bullies. And they all knew each other. They all belonged to the same neighborhood. And these three bullies, they were scared of Maxwell. He had his flip knife with him as usual. So they were scared and they ran away from there. And this small child, this foreigner, he was saved. And this boy, he thanked Maxwell and he said, "Appearances can be so deceptive. I had a totally different impression about you, seeing you with your tattoo and your knife all the time. I didn't think you were this kind of person. You have saved my life. And back where I come from, we believe that when somebody saves your life, you owe them a debt which you spend the rest of your life repaying." He said that and he ran away. Maxwell grew up, became a policeman. 30 years later, he was traveling. He was in the Bangkok airport. He was standing in line to clear the security check. And behind him was this young mother. She had two small children. She was carrying a baby and she was struggling with a number of bags. And so she requested Maxwell, "Can you please carry this bag for me?" And she was obviously struggling with all that she was handling, trying to handle. And so Maxwell felt sorry for her. She apparently looked like she needed some help. And so he took the bag from her. But very soon, the sniffer dogs, they caught him. And it turned out that that bag had stashed in it some narcotic drugs. And he was caught. Now, this was a very, very serious offense. And there was a fast track, a super fast track case, trial in court. And things looked very, very bad for him. The girl had looked so helpless, but now she was missing. As soon as the police came, she escaped. And so Maxwell was in court, and there was no witness, nobody to support him, and nobody believed him when he said all this. And he said, finally, "Appearances can be so deceptive." And the judge looked at him very strangely. And unexpectedly, the judge said, "You're free because you're innocent." And then later on, the judge explained, "You saved my life 30 years back when I was a child in the US. And he just repaid that debt. Now, we all come across many such real life incidents. Maybe we have experienced something like this ourselves, if not so dramatic. Or we read a couple separated during the World War in Europe, meeting after years after the war in America. Or a word spoken in jest coming through unexpectedly, or else even finding a lost object after a very long time in a totally unexpected place. So we generally call all this chance. But when we say chance, what exactly have we explained? When we say chance, we have really not proven anything, basically. Chance implies that we have not found any physical causality that led to the event, just as we heard in the discussion before. Only that which can be explained by the laws of physical science, they are accepted as scientific, as valid. Nothing else has that legitimacy. But then we also know that over the centuries, our knowledge of science and what is established as scientific fact has steadily grown. Before we discovered microorganisms, we wondered what caused disease or why it spread from one person to another, or what was the connection between stagnant water and say malaria in that vicinity. And after we learned about germs, what was a mystery became understandable. Many other mysteries like this have been solved this way as science progressed. There were strange, fantastic explanations for the solar eclipse till we learned about space. So perhaps there are new laws, deeper and more subtle, yet to be discovered. So what is unrealized is not necessarily unrealizable. We heard about the placebo effect yesterday and the Pygmalion effect. When the teacher has high expectations from a student, there is a positive impact on the child's performance. In the case of the placebo, the psychological element, it impacts the physical body. In the Pygmalion effect, the impact is even more subtle. It is on the performance, the accomplishment of the child later on. Which leads to the question, are there greater subtleties of science and causality yet to be discovered? I come from a culture where we believe that all life incidents, they depend on much more than what is there on the physical plane. Our literature is filled with this, not just Indian literature, but world literature mentions, in fact, prolifically mentions such a phenomenon. But such traditional beliefs, they have been stifled by the scientific revolution. And only that which can be validated by physical laws and replicated in the laboratory have been accepted as knowledge. Perhaps as physical laws have grown, there are further planes and subtler levels of causality that will be validated scientifically in future. So I would like to leave you with this question or with this thought. If we know nothing about light and refraction, when we see a rainbow, we will be able to admire it as something beautiful, and that is all. We will not be able to understand, we won't be able to explain it or replicate it at will. All we can do is smile, admire it, and maybe call it chance. So what if what we smile and admire today is something that we may be able to understand, explain, and scientifically prove in future? Thank you.